order, please stand for the pledge, remain standing for a brief prayer.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to our brother for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Our heavenly Father, we thank you for all our blessings, and we ask to continue your blessings on the path before us. Please bless us our efforts with clear insight and our decisions with impartiality. Please give us your guidance, wisdom, and support as we begin this meeting. Continue to remind us that we are here today for the pursuit of truth, for the greater glory of you, and for the service of humanity. We are also thankful for celebrating Thanksgiving, and we thank you for being with us in all our joys and sorrows. We thank you for friends, for help, and for grace. May we live this and every day thankful of all that has been given to us. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
By title note, we have a meeting change. The meeting originally scheduled for Tuesday, December 4th is now being moved to Tuesday, December 11th because the county council meets a week earlier that month. We need to make sure we've got enough time so we can act on anything that council acts on. So once again, we will not have our normal public meeting on December 4th, but we move to December 11th. All right.
Will there still be a claims meeting?
There will be. All right, moving on to reports. First order of business is opening reading of bids. I don't believe there are any. We can move on to reports and requests. Board of Commissioners, first item is the accounts payable docket. Is there a motion?
Motion to approve.
Second.
There's a motion to second. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passes. Next item, Indiana Enterprise Center limited land agreement, addendum number one. Who's it?
Good morning, Bill Shalio, Economic Development Offices on the 11th floor. Before you today is a proposal for agreement, addendum number one with Lehman and Lehman, to continue providing services related to the Indiana Enterprise Center, specifically related to their services for master planning and land use plan development. The addendum is for $60,000, and this will supplement their prior contracts. The Redevelopment Commission approved this contract on October 9th. Questions, I would be happy to answer.
Council, there are a couple things that need to get worked out that has taken place.
I thought this one table just gives you information coming back.
Yes, that was.
So this is just an amendment to an existing agreement to add some additional services.
That's correct.
Any question or comment?
Comments? Thank you. I'm not a very fan of all the developments that are out there, secret. Well, certainly, the question of a large amount of expenditure under expectation. So, this is addendum number one for $60,000 on top of the original contract for $100,000, right? So, a 60% increase?
That would be correct, yes.
It seems pretty significant. I appreciate your report that you've included that showed you know, the seven firms and everything at the beginning of summer, and you're getting all these contracts. And this is the second highlighted item, $2,000.
Yes.
I was wondering why the other two items that's on this report, $98,440,000, $107,900, why weren't those addendums?
They were actually back several months ago.
Okay. But they weren't considered numbers one.
No, these are actually specific work scopes that were above the original contract.
And I do appreciate this report. I think it'd be even more accurate to show the cost of accounting services that's been paid out, the cost of legal services, any other administrative expenses that's gone along with this project. I do recall seeing in the news the other day that in the treating article, the Interior Group received a $100,000 contract. $50,000 from the County Development Commission and $50,000 from the Maintenance Board. Did you start our campaign there?
I did, yes.
I don't recall the Board of Commissioners approving that interlocal agreement. Did you?
It actually just went through the Redevelopment Commission. It was a contract. It was referred to legal to review how that needed to be funded. So it went through the Redevelopment Commission for their approval.
Okay. And then it go off for bid?
It did, actually. Nick did have five. No, they actually had seven vendors, and they narrowed it down to one, and selected Antero.
And is there any, what was the reason that didn't come before this board, final approval, like most contracts, did it revolve around fiber optic?
Which has nothing to do with fiber optic, so, I would defer to legal.
Where's part of the statute, if our vendor is a local, interlocal agreement with the city, we just maybe determine if it's government hiring or acting.
But if what all, then considering the awarding of a contract, $50,000, the taxpayer, which considered being a broker.
I don't think the county awarded contract, making awards of contract, we would participate in.
I think you have been more transparent, cleaner, who would approve it, the contractor expenditure, as a customer earlier, and also would approve it with the union. But thank you for this good report.
You had asked for it previously, and I want to make sure it was properly provided.
Thank you, and I think he's got, that goes up.
Any questions, comments? Your motion?
Motion to approve is, ending the year, and then the year, and then the one.
Second, we have a motion, and second, all in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Aye.
Motion passes. Next up, SF Motor Development Agreement.
So nearly a year ago, I believe it was almost on November 1st, October 31st, November 1st, SF Motors purchased the former AM General Commercial Division property on McKinley Avenue. Shortly thereafter, we began a series of conversations with SF Motors representatives. Those conversations have culminated in this development agreement before you today. We've been working on this for nearly a year. And so I'd like to walk through the development agreement very briefly, cover some of the points, and then if there's any questions, I would be happy to answer them. As part of this agreement, SF Motors will purchase the property at 12900 McKinley Highway. That has already been done. This will be purchased for the specific purpose of creating electric vehicles. The investment by the company is estimated or is required to be $20 million. And must be complete by March 31st of 2019. As I will detail later, they have spent more than $20 million as part of their commitment. Employment. The company estimates that we'll employ full-time no less than 100 people by March 31st, 2019. At this point in time, they have employed only or nearly that amount of people. Wages. Wages are to be competitive within the automotive industry. And will be an hourly basis, roughly at $26 an hour, as I understand the agreement. The employment of local contractors, they're required to use local contractors when commercially reasonable efforts can be made. And again, we'll detail that as part of the supplemental material. State incentives, SF Motors applied to the state for a variety of different incentives. All of those have been approved by the state of Indiana. From the county side, the county was asked to support a personal property tax abatement for 7 years under $20 million of new investment. That was approved by the Common Council on October 9th of 2018. It is important to note that this property sits within the AM General Economic Development Area, and the Redevelopment Commission is the only party that will have any adverse impact by the granting of this tax abatement. The only party that will not collect increment will be the Redevelopment Commission during the period of this investment. There's a table here on the second page that shows the investment scale. Abatement compliance. The company will be required to meet all abatement compliance requirements set forth within the county ordinance. The county will support an industrial recovery tax credit or a dyno tax credit that again was granted by the state. Expansion support. When and if the company seeks to expand, the Redevelopment Commission owns property immediately adjacent to the EVAP facility. That property is currently on a year-to-year lease, has been on a year-to-year lease since 2001. The lease terms expire in 2051. The company pays a one-time payment once a year. of nearly just over $71,000. That will continue. In the case that the company wants to expand, there is a provision in the lease agreement that would allow the company to buy all or part of that land. There's a provision in the agreement on utility support. If additional utilities need to be run to the site, the county would support those efforts. Support could mean either financially or by just being a participating party and bringing parties to the table. At this point in time, real property tax determination has been done with the Penn Township Assessor's Office. That has been done. That is now recorded in the property process, but we were supportive of that work. And again, at this point in time, no real property tax abatement is eligible because there's nothing for real property, real property tax abatement to be granted for the property. So there's no real property tax abatement that has been requested. There was an issue that came up during one of the many meetings that we had with the council, and I would turn to one of the supplemental pages. The council was interested in having an understanding of union versus non-union contractor work that was being done on the site. Presently, right now, 73% of the work done on the site has been done by union work. That's actually $20.4 million worth of work that's been done on site in total. And 73% of that, or 14.8%, is 14.8 million has been done by union laborers. And of the 61 total contracts issued, 82% or 50 contracts have been done by union workers. There are some, I can't say enough. We've been working on this project for a year. This company has been great to work with. We're excited about their investment in the property. We feel that this investment will help with investors looking at the property on the other side of the fence. As the military division has some opportunity for some repurposing or maybe potential acquisition. So we're excited about this. We see that our partnership with SF Motors will extend long into the future. We're excited about having our community placed into the marketplace with electric vehicles. And we think this is nothing but a win for the community. A year ago, we could have really should have had zero workers working on site. On today. But because of their investment, we have people working on the site. We'll have hundreds of people working on the site. We've seen millions of dollars invested in the site to date, and we'll continue to see that. So this is a slam dunk project. The county's involvement in this project is pretty minimal in scope and for the return on the investment. So I would ask for your support. If there's any questions, I would be happy to answer.
Thank you. This is truly a transformational project. People look back 5, 10, 20 years into the future. We look back at this time. It's truly a very critical point in economic development. Any questions or comments?
I would be remiss real quick if I didn't also thank Jamie Woods and Steve Dalton. They spent an incredible amount of work on this, and Mike Triple also. But all three were just very instrumental. It was a cough, but yes.
And it's a very good report. You gave us one a few months ago, and you hit on some of those topics today, such as the hourly wage being roughly $26 an hour. And at that time, I asked if that was that lease package including insurance and retirement for us, and you said no. But that was actual gross wage. We also discussed the word support. Mm-hmm. We support utilities. We support rail expansion. And you mentioned now there could be a financial cost, but and then you'll probably spell out the contract. But I went through where I couldn't find support really defined. So we aren't necessarily obligated to pay for all of that. They can ask us and we can say,
that's correct. The word is support. So support, but not required.
Sometimes support is required.
Yes.
Okay. Well, I think that's important. You know, I think it was Saturday's paper on the front page had a good article that said, you know, when tracking development, you don't sell your soul. I think it was a reference to the Amazon chase that there are many communities went through. A few days ago on Channel 34, they actually had a show called What Happened to Dayton, Ohio. They showed that Chinese firm came in and bought the General Motors plant, and they were paying auto industrial wages, which was basically the way roads were to pay. And UAW and others complained we can't afford to pay our workers to live on low wages. And they said, well, it's more than we pay our workers in China. And that they were in the process of transforming the process of like third friends around the country at this point in the documentary. So I'm very concerned when I see that happening elsewhere in America. I'm glad that there was some work trying to do it, right? Watch flavor for the agreement. I commend the council for holding them to that and then at least checking into it. And that hopefully they will amend their abatement statutes to include that. It's certainly, if we're sacrificing something for our community to help the business, they should be strong in it, not just for the business. The 7-year abatement always made me question why is 7-year abatement? Normally, anybody who qualifies for 7 would certainly sort of qualify for that, understanding the way the system works. But then I do respect the fact that you and others, that they are receiving 10 years of the credit in the 7-year period, basically. So, it's a 7-year payment, but all in all, I hope this turns out to be a good time. And, is there a possibility that when we own some land, we would grow it? Is there a possibility that we would have to use other things to make their land?
As we sit here today, I can't answer that question. The land that we own is pretty substantial. The land that we own was purchased under the color of eminent domain in the past. Eminent domain was not used on any of the 52 parcels. So we cannot sit here and say what the future will have a hold. We can only hope that this company continues to grow and requires at least our land for future growth.
Thank you. I hope so too. Now with this negotiation, this project and many others, that we really negotiate with the best thing we can for our citizens. That we don't just, they ask for all these cuts and discounts. We just really are good when we do that. That we make sure that we are receiving things for the cost of the benefit of our taxpayers and the increases on our infrastructure that our businesses have. Thank you, Mr. Shallon. Mm-hmm.
There are other questions or comments. Is there a motion?
Motion to approve the Aspect Motor Development Agreement.
So to that, Judith Robleski, 515 South Main Street in South Bend, Indiana, zip code 46619. Thank you. This is, I've been thinking a lot about this agreement since Ted Booker's last Wednesday's article in the South Bend Tribune. And it brought up a whole stream of questions as I read through it. So regarding the wages, that's considered the average, is how Ted Booker put it in the article. So what is the wage range? As far as the abatement, this is, our county has a very poor record of following through on tax abatement promises and agreements. And so my question is, why don't we act like bankers? This is our county's land. And why don't we ask for a deposit of 2/7 of the $900,000, which is a near approximate figure of their tax abatement, which is a 10-year amount in 7 years. So why don't they put down a deposit, SF Motors put down a deposit of 2/7 of that to start with? So if they fail through on their agreement for the 100 jobs, provided these jobs provide enough living wage jobs, we don't want to go by an average figure. We want to know the breakdown of how many jobs we'll get so much at different levels of employment, different jobs. So am I clear? Have any questions?
I think that's a really good question. Several good questions.
Also, China doesn't have a very good, they're noted for contaminating the country, their air, their water, their land. And they have plenty of people that could use this job. So why do they want to come here? That's another question that a lot of people have. Why are they coming here? When they have all this land, they're a big country, they've taken over other countries to add to their country. So why are they now coming here? And then if they're leasing this from the Redevelopment Commission, or whoever owns, according to Ted Booker, it is a leased property. So we're the landlord. So what's, how much are they paying for the lease? Pardon me?
We do not own it.
Who owns the property that they're on, that they're leasing from?
Yeah, I think they own the building, and I think they're leasing the parking lot in the Redevelopment Commission, correct?
They already purchased land here.
Yeah, they own the building.
The building, but what they own the building and the land that the building's on?
They own that land as well. They are leasing the parking lot. Mr. Shelley, right? Not even. Right, correct.
Okay, thank you. That wasn't clear in the newspaper article.
I tend to be correct.
Yes. Thank you. So, well, then there should be a lease arrangement payment to the Redevelopment Commission for that.
Yeah, I think it's about $700,000.
Okay, that was apparent in the article in the paper. So the details of it.
I would comment on some of your questions you brought up so far. The wage range, I think that would be important. Just like earlier I mentioned, it would support even better defined, you know, and because wage range, you could have probably 100 people making minimum wage, and then someone else making several million, and I'm sure there's somewhere there that you can come up with. I don't know. I just have to hope for the best. Monitoring tax payments, I think the county council has become much better at monitoring tax payments than they were 10 years ago.
Anyway, so let's, you have any other comments?
No.
Well,
no.
You can.
I have other comments, but time would not allow, I don't think.
Is there a 3-minute limit on these topics?
Sure.
I would like to see this table so we could go over the more detail and feel comfortable with this arrangement. I mean, if we don't care for our land, who is? Somebody in China? Come on.
Thank you.
So I think the council's done a way better job of monitoring tax payments. If you go back 10, 12 years ago, there was not even any unit there, any monitoring going on. The abatements were rubber stamped, didn't hear to anybody from my point of view. Then that's where they change the abatement ordinance to make it you have to return, and there's punitive damages if you don't properly earn that. So they've got better. The idea of making a deposit or a bond of 2/7, that's an interesting concept. The abatement plan is run by the county council, the legislative body, and you're welcome to mention that to the legislative body, or a body of that nature, if you like. And again, I've heard the rumor, oh, it's good, that they might want to hire a staff to help track these things. And yes, it is, and China is well known for the gambling environment. Sometimes this country, sadly, has exported our pollution and a form of slavery that we send jobs overseas where children are making 37 cents a day, or they'll pollute their country's environment instead of our environment. So there is a great deal of sadness all the way around when it comes to the environment, the way it's treated. We talked about the leasing of the parking lot. Is there any other thing to say about this contract?
At this point, I don't know enough to make any more comments.
Right. Any other questions?
But I would like this to be tabled so we could look at it and feel more comfortable with it. I appreciate all the work that's done on it, but this is not a comfortable situation at this point. Thank you.
All right. Any other questions or comments? Is there a motion?
Second.
Motion and second. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed. Motion passes. All right. Next up, we have an appointment to the Historic Preservation.
I'll second that. I have a question for Paul.
Okay. Good motion. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed. All right.
Council, the request comes and it states that she's a non-Democrat representative. Would it be more proper say Republican representative?
No, I think that that is a probably technical term. I'm familiar with the term as it relates to the appointment of magistrates in the state of the county. It doesn't say one has to be an R and one has to be a P if they're non-Democratic or non-Republican. So I think that's probably the correct term for the statute. But I'm not looking at that, but that phrase doesn't surprise me.
There's typically been, you don't have to be one in this case.
So it could be a Green Party.
It could be an independent, it could be non-actual.
So it could be, it might be more clear to say non-political?
No, it could be political, there is not Democratic or not Republican.
Okay. It just seems odd to say non-Democratic.
Yeah. That's what people downstairs make the point.
Thank you.
Are there any other nominations? Hearing none, I'll close nominations. All those in favor of appointing Elizabeth Hurdle to the Historic Preservation Commission, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passes. Avoid. Since you're up there.
Yeah, it's already done though, correct?
Yes.
So I can say anything.
You can say whatever you want.
I'll start by saying.
If Bill tell us he's a Democrat, otherwise, who knows what's going to happen then?
Good morning, County Commissioner. Very nice to be you. I'm Alicia Fugel. I'm the Administrator of the Historic Preservation Commission. And I'm here today with Elizabeth Hurdle, who, as you mentioned, has served on the Preservation Commission since 2014. She is the non-Democratic, but she is a Republican serving. But it is correct the way that it's written. Without describing that, I'd like to tell you a little bit more about Elizabeth. She, like I said, she has served since 2014 as the County Commissioner's non-Democratic. She is a Mishawaka resident and is also a lieutenant paramedic firefighter with the Buffalo Fire Department, which she has done for 15 years. Also, while working full-time in that position, she received her degree in history and anthropology, so she's well-suited for that reason as well as serving on the organization. And she is also working to achieve her master's, actually one class away. So I'm very thankful that you decided to reappoint Elizabeth Hurdle. She has been expired for about a year now.
Thank you. As a current serving member of the board, you actually know how much work it is.
I do. You
still
yes.
Want this.
I do.
Okay. Just checking.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. All right. And then moving on. Bills passed by the St. Joseph County Council at a public hearing held on November 13, 2018. Council took the following action. Bill 7718 became ordinance 5818, salary amendment for the maintenance department. Bill 7818, ordinance 5918, salary amendment for the auditor's office. Bill 7618, ordinance 6018, which would be monthly transfer appropriations. And Bill 7518 became ordinance 6218, which is the code book amendment regarding licensing and registration for the adopted project. Any questions or comments regarding any of these items?
Thank you. Mr. Murphy is going to ask you if it's all right. The first two items, kind of seems to be the greatest for housekeeping that there never is. Minor adjustment for 5918. Those adjustments were made in the 2019 budget. They have it. Next one.
The first one.
Housekeeper having it. It's over time, so.
Yeah, it's over time.
And then the 6018, there's nearly $279,000 increases in utilities for the courthouse, the jail, county city building. I hate to see anything be understated for 2019. Do you think 2019 might be understated, or are these numbers in the 2018 budget?
These numbers are in the 2018 budget, but you have to monitor.
I'm sorry,
we may have to, for
2019?
Performance service contract.
No, it's not 2018.
there may be a lot of not the main cost.
Thank you. Then my last question might be for this part. The ordinance 60 adopt a block. The $50 fee, is that just cover the cost of the time? Super, thank you. And I'll acknowledge that this part is both seven four and not even the other. Thank you.
Any question, comment? Fair motion.
Motion to approve the ordinance 60-69.
Second.
Motion second, all in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passes. All right, now, come to the things that we enjoy getting to do, recognize some of our county employees. So first, Catherine Chen began working for St. Joseph County in January 20th, 1995. She served as secretary with the Bell Probation Department until March 13th, 1995, at which time she was appointed as a probation officer. Since then, she's worked as a probation officer and during her tenure has supervised thousands of cases ranging from low-level misdemeanors to high-level felonies. Her work has included monitoring defendants' compliance with court requirements, maintaining certification as a probation officer by completing all the continuing education requirements, all while working to effectuate change in the lives of those that she has been. For her tireless service to our community, courts, and the county, more than 33 years should not go unnoticed, that she is retiring from her position in November of 2000. Upon this occasion of retirement, Catherine Chen, we, the Board of Commissioners, are honored to present this to the county, token of our gratitude for 33 years of service as a citizen of St. Joseph County on this 20th day, November 2000. This is the highest honor we can present any member or any citizen of St. Joseph County. We very gladly present that today.
And a real physical people.
We're not sure when it opens, but it's fantastic.
Catherine, you want to say a couple words? You don't have to, it's whatever. How fantastic your supervisor was, of course, will be.
Or not.
It made it possible to be here this long. And thank the county for the team. I think it's really recognition of all the employees who put in a lot of time. Thank you for not missing that.
Commissioner Fleming, our employee of the month.
We're so excited every year to recognize our employees of the month and highlight and update people that are really serving our community and our time. So this year, we'll have an employee's name is Terry McCree, who since becoming an employee with the Penn Township Assessor's Office, she has been an example for professionalism. This quarter, she has entered and researched over 1,500 appeals with zero backlog. As a result, we are anticipating all appeals to resolve prior to the tax bill to be issued, which will be tax savings both the county and taxpayers alike. So again, thank you very much. So here is your employee of the month. Come on up.
Your name will also appear in the lobby in our Thank you so much. Would you like to say a couple words? You're more than welcome to, or
I just want to thank my boss, Dr. Young Lady Moon.
Move on to the Hospital Authority of St. Joseph County resolution authorizing issuance of bond.
Commissioners, Philip Ascenda from Bartlett Over 100 North Michigan Street, South Bend. The action of the County Commissioners that's requested of the County Commissioners this morning is to approve the action of the hospital for the expenses for County from last week. The County Commissioners are under the Internal Revenue Code, who are the authorized elected representative that is necessary for the issuance of tax lien bonds on the project. The project is, and I'm here on behalf of Beacon Health System. The project is a new 38,000 square foot hospital to be located on Beacon Parkway. And a corresponding 50,000, approximately 50,000, but actually going to be closer to 560,000 office building that will be used for Beacon operations primarily, and administrative operations. If you're familiar with Beacon, they have a location in South Bend, Memorial Hospital, the primary, and Elkhart General, and Elkhart County. This location is right in the same town, and that's why it's desirous for the corporation to be able to locate here. The hospital will be primarily emergency services. There will be 21 rooms, 11 of which will be for emergency rooms, and 10 of which will be inpatients. It's not only large, but it does serve the population and a location. They are going to be consolidating some services, essentially relocating people to this facility from temporary space that they currently have. They are not, therefore, promising any new jobs, although with 80-some thousand square feet new construction, they would anticipate there would be some. They do not want to promise any more because they're relocating people in September. It was a unanimous decision of the hospital board without the resolution, and it was a $40 million. And this financing. There are no taxes or tax levy or credit of the county that's pledged to the fund at all. This is very similar to what the Commissioner McNeil did in the past year financing. This is very similar. Happy to answer.
Thank you, Dean. I'm certainly glad this is going forward, that we can just complete as part of the commitment. I just remember the news story, I mentioned that. To have South Bend Memorial, South Bend St. Joe, Mishawaka St. Joe, osteopathic in Jefferson Boulevard. That way we have lost hospital. The private community with better care, better health care than most. So I'm happy to see it happen. If they will, they're not asking for a abatement or anything like that, so it's not my position to say, like you might have heard me through this shout, say, hold the people fire, get the best for next year. Because this is a hospital, and there are regular things. Thank you for
having me. Another question. Is there a motion?
Motion to approve the possibility to do the bond.
Second. Second. All in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed. Motion passed. Moving on to the Department of Health. Request approval of lease agreement with Enterprise.
Good morning. Amy Rupi, Finance Manager for the Department of Health with offices on the 89th floor of the County City Building. The Department of Health currently has 13 county vehicles for its field staff. The majority of those vehicles are upwards of 18 to 19 years old and have cost us a lot of money in repair over the most recent years. We have entered into a possible agreement with Enterprise, which is the same program that the County Highway Department uses. You lease vehicles for 5 years and then get new vehicles after 5 years. You would get 2 Ford F-150 trucks and 11 Nissan Versas for our field staff. We have included that in our 2019 budget by moving money around and flatline the budget to be able to do the lease.
Questions, comments?
Ms.
Rupi,
I'll
also
favor of the getting I'm not sure if the funding mechanics are usually when anybody gets bids, we have to approve them and request So I don't know if that happened. My hence the enterprise bids, as long as it's not required by the law, I'm not gonna think about that issue. I am concerned that electric vehicles are inside. Because we have a county ordinance passed by the legislative by the county council and board of commissioners to buy their. So if you weren't aware of that, and you're doing your dysfunction, you're probably.
Correct, he initiated this in accordance with requirement.
Okay, so we have a county ordinance applying there. That way we're again supporting American workers, spending our taxpayer dollars to help other taxpayers. We have such a beautiful country, that's why people quite come here. And if I did check with Nissan, and these wouldn't be here, like.
Correct.
And they're manufactured in Aquas, like only this part of the situation, Mexico, 300 miles from us. So, I would refer to counselor or even this clerk, if she approved the decision process regarding enterprise, but I cannot support filing the binder. Does she reference the Iowa?
I think she was referencing the same program.
Same program at the Highway Department, also in its second year.
Yeah, but I think Jessica still expects, you can't respect her, because there's a lot of vehicle problems with that. And maybe we can have a binder. Although I strongly want you guys to have vehicles, I cannot support my inside vehicle. For our taxpayers, their dollars, their earnings.
I think it would apply to all acquisitions, my recollection of applying there. I think the more interesting part is what steps to the health department there or propose how to do in that field.
Is that state contract? Sometimes there's a first time. So then, Counselor, what is your?
I think you should table this, and I hear some further information from the health department again, and what they would be displaying in the spring time. If you were to know that they're on the.
Okay. Like that motion exists. Yeah, before that, and also recommend talking to this clerk, I did say this, as well as I think it's major to the agenda, if that doesn't.
I think it's fine to advise them, but the health department, I think it's only turning with you.
Oh, I know, but I'm just my advice, I think it's major.
Is there a motion?
Motion to table.
Second. Motion to second, all in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passes. All right, public safety communication consortium, first item, request approval of HIP contract revision.
Good morning, Ray Schultz, Executive Director of PSAP, 5266 down the avenue, requesting an addendum to our contract with Edge IT to increase the number of hours. We did an upgrade to our system October 23rd, which has caused us to expend all of the hours that we had initially designed to do another project. So this would refill our hours so that project can be completed. This is an estimate. It's a should not exceed this 150 hours for the rest of the year based upon what project we have contract. So we would not have needed this addendum had we not had some pretty significant issues that arose from our upgrade.
But you've also had refilled your.
Correct. Yes,
we do that. Position for part of this is that money is some that which could be used to make sure that it's.
Correct. I will say that during this time that this company has provided sometimes two and three technicians at a time to work through these stability issues with our CAD vendors. So it's not just getting a person; it's getting several people.
Questions or comments?
Thank you. As I sort of spoke with the official earlier, the cost is really high. Is
This is for a contract for $125 an hour at 150 hours. We completed by December 31st. That's basically almost $19,000 for the month of December. Under the circumstances that you are short of I can support it. But I also recommend that I know you are working for a better long term solution.
Yes, sir.
And as I recommended, you know, allow Ariel great IT measures for the county. They might have everything. But so I support it as a temporary emergency need.
Thank you. Any other questions, Scott? Is there a motion?
Second.
Second, all in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passes. Request approval of Lakeville Power VHF contract.
So, when the Lakeville Tower project was completed, there was an omission, and we have not been able to service the southern half of the county with the VHF paging capabilities they need. We had had a initial quote of over $70,000 to do this, and included some other system upgrades that were caused by some issues with maintenance. Both maintenance. What we did was we decided to scale the project back, take the equipment off of the old tower, put it on the new tower. So that significantly reduced the price to this current contract. This is an essential service that we provide to our volunteer firefighters in the southern part of the county. This is how they get alerted at night when they're at work. And it should have been done earlier, kind of managing through this project and finding exactly what the sweet spot was financially was a challenge. So I think we've come to a pretty good agreement with Motorola.
Questions or comments? I commend Mr.
Belcher giving this here. He said that it probably should have happened earlier. It's a very important vital key to the safety of the people outside. I think they are required to support it.
Any other questions or comments? Is there a motion?
Motion to approve the electric power lease contract with Motorola.
Second. Motion second. All in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passed. Finally, request approval of snow removal contract.
So we did need to do something different this year when it comes to snow removal at PSAP. We are on an island, as that's really a function of maintenance, but it exceeds the capabilities of our current maintenance department. The way we change shifts every 4 hours, there needs to be a little more attention paid to removing snow and salt. We did have several workman's comp claims last year for slip and fall injuries, which we hope to prevent. And it's out of the scope that we currently can provide. Talk with County Highway, and they're willing to do things if we get like a lot of snow to help out in emergency, but come out every 4 hours and shovel and salt, kind of strain their manpower as well. So we did solicit other companies too, and I apologize if I should have done a formal bid process. We did solicit other companies on this time and material project. And this is the lone respondent to that. So it's a local person, lives close to PSAP, works for the fire department, is capable of being on this.
From your end, the maintenance portion was taken out of the budget, so this is the recourse you have.
Correct.
Any questions or comments?
I'm here to look for either in house, but I understand that the short staff. I appreciate you talking to the highway department. I know they're going to be doing a good job with proper process. All our council is close to that issue.
Thanks for being
on the comment on that. But so it is a critical need for understanding
that it's a service agreement.
It doesn't matter.
Peter J. Augustino, 131 South Taylor Street. Thank you. This is a service contract. It does not have to follow the bidding process.
Right.
But I think, as Mr. Schultz indicated, he did make an attempt to find a better price.
And second, finally, any other questions, Kevin? Your motion.
Motion to approve the snow removal contract with Zero Company Maintenance.
Second. Motion to second. All in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you, Ray.
Thank you.
Next up, Superior Court requests approval of Family Court Project Grant Application. Your Honor.
Good morning. David Schaffo, St. Joseph's Superior Court, 101 South Main Street. I'm here to ask your approval of the grant application I submitted to the Indiana Supreme Court. They have a Family Court Grant Project, and they distribute money throughout the state. I don't know whether they're there or not, but the reason for it is traditionally the Superior and Circuit Courts have done the divorce cases and probate courts and the juvenile paternity cases. Judge Fox asked that we take over some of the caseload because he had an increase in the Chins cases, so we agreed to do that. And with the prosecutor, we took 40% of the prosecutor-initiated juvenile paternity cases starting in the beginning of this year. And we traditionally have a rule for divorcing parents to go through a class called the Paid and Transparent. And these classes are self-funded. They're charged with fee, no county money is used to pay them employees or anything for them. So I'm not anticipating that a new class for paternity parents will cost money. But it's a different socioeconomic group. And the money charged in the Paid and Transparent class may not be available to those people who are in the paternity class. The emphasis is on early childhood development, and working with Jay Capaniga, hoping to find some of the programs at the Robinson Center. Excellent facility, well managed. The people there, and they have a program called Talk with Your Baby, and it ties into this target group of parents, custodial parents, with children from 0 to 5. And the research shows that they have so many neurons and so many synapses, and they lose it over time, but on sponges, and if you can get them reading books, and we're going to tie into the Community Foundation, where the Dolly Parton program gives a book a month to kids, and we talk to the baby children, and other resources from the community press shop. Hopefully, we'll have a representative. So that's the purpose of the class, that's the purpose of the grant application, get some seed money in case we can't use it. So we have any money to pay rent. I don't know how it's going to go. We're still planning this program. But that gives a brief summary.
Questions or comments?
I thank Your Honor for coming here and meeting with staff, watching TV programs, applying for it. So you know, it's going to be beneficial to you. Know, but it's great that you're trying to think outside the box. You mentioned the Robinson Center, so like the fresh outside area, but work with the board. Or other groups who need help, say this is a great organization. And that was just mentioned to you and your staff, our county Bureau Extension, they do helping cooking classes and some parent classes. They might have your staff, yeah, maybe they can synergize with any of the Purdue staff or their program, in which they often think they're only 4-H in the country, outside the city. But they actually do tell you a lot within the city.
We'll add them to the resource, the list of if anyone would want to come to do extension with them and say a few words, we'd love that.
Yeah, they're trying to use my equipment in our, food stamp budget, how to eat healthy. So many times today, a person does not know what to put a bag of flour, how to put rice or noodles, and then they buy a bunch of unhealthy food for the children. Instead of the socialization process of cooking and eating together.
Any other questions or comments? Is there a motion? Motion to approve the consent agenda. Second. Second. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye. Aye. Opposed? Thank you, Your Honor. All right, next, the Department of Public Works, first item is the consent agenda. We'll note that you're both will stand by letter of credit for Grand Shore subdivision sections 1 through 4. Your vote will stand by a letter of credit, North Brook Shore Subdivision and a Subdivision Improvement Performance Bond to the village at Cobblestone Square. Questions, comments regarding any of these items? Is there a motion?
Motion to approve.
Second. Motion and second. All in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passed. Next item, request approval of NDOT contract R36488, enhancing bike pedestrian facility, Adams Road, from Elm Road to County. Country Knowles Drive, recommendation for acceptance.
Good morning, Jessica Clark, County Engineer with offices here in this building, room 732. Before you is a NDOT required form, which is the recommendation for acceptance for to close the financial fiscal records on this particular federal aid project, which was our Adamsville extension from Home Road through the Fields Road.
Questions or comments?
Although I don't have any constituents in the Queens area, I still run into many people who just love this program. And they said, you know, that was through all of Kansas, love it. And fortunately, the neighbors that got together to help with their matching portion. They have the citizens walk around, by talking to each other, and just such an alternative.
It's certainly a community building project, but again, it all credit goes to First Grade Park for their direction and willingness to fundraise the monies to be able to provide that 20% share.
Yeah, the passionate vote.
Any other questions, Scott? Your motion?
Motion to approve the NDOT contract for the
Second. Motion is second. All in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passes. Next, request approval of agreement for engineering services, bridge number S605, with Badger Cave Creek on Rainbow Creek.
This is a design for preliminary engineering agreement to replace the structure on Redwood Road. The amount is not to exceed $117,900, and the services include the design work, hydraulic modeling, permits, documentation, plans, etc., to prepare the project for letting.
Questions, comments?
I'm glad as soon as we move forward, Redwood is a very well traveled artery for the southern part of the county, and the bridge is definitely needed there.
Any other questions, comments? Second. Motion to second. All in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passes. Next, request approval of agreement for engineering services, bridge number S575, over Leskowski Ditch on Trump Down Trail.
Similarly, this again is a design agreement to replace this bridge structure in an amount not to exceed $108,100. And again, the services include the hydraulic modeling, the designing, preparing the plans, permits, etc., to prepare for lighting and replacement.
Great comments. Very much. Second. Motion second. All in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passes. Finally, request approval of architect engineering services for design, bid assistance, and construction, phase for 3 highway maintenance garage facilities, consultant selection award.
As you are aware, we solicited through RFP for these proposals. We received them June 26th. We did receive 4, one from American Structure Point, DLD Indiana, Joe P. Rufinski, and RQAW Architects. We utilized a quality-based selection process, and our scoring team narrowed the 4 to 3 finalists that we then did interview on and considered the presentations they made for their proposals at those interviews, and at this time we recommend DLD as the most responsive proposer and would request the board's approval to authorize us to begin negotiations to establish a contract to look at scheduling and planning for the replacement and construction of 3 new garage facilities. Again, we have 6 existing satellite highway campuses right now. This process, the Board of Commissioners looked at where these facilities needed to be sited, I want to say toward the late 60s and the 70s. And at that time, that was the decision and how they moved forward. And ironically enough, it actually was Cole Associates that did that study. And moving forward, we have looked at consolidating from those 6 sites to 3 sites within the county to better serve our community from an operational standpoint and an efficiency standpoint. We look to save nearly $400,000 to $500,000 a year in just utilities, equipment, and repairs on those highway garage sites. Unfortunately, through the years, the maintenance funds had not been dedicated to keep them in a position where they are fully usable today. The other aspect of that is there are existing challenges on the site, and they're just merely physical constraints, where the needs of our community back in the late 60s or the 70s is significantly different than what those needs are today. and we feel and recommend that we can better serve those needs with that consolidation, better utilizing those funds, better utilizing the equipment, better utilizing our labor hours to serve the livability community. And this contract will help us plan and schedule how to make that consolidation.
One of the keys is that we have known operational shortcomings, but more importantly, facility shortcomings. So sometimes it means financial timing that people are wondering why we would spend on building new highway garages when we have existing ones. The challenge is the money we would have to put into our existing garage to get them up to the level of service they need to be would be very close, if not more, than it would be to construct new ones that would then give us operational.
And unfortunately, logistically, the sites, they just don't provide the same service, but the level of service we want to provide with consolidation to realize those savings, you just can't use the location of where they are.
We're going to be spending these funds either upgrading what we have, improving what we have, or building new facilities that are more designed to function differently.
And this design horizon, we're looking to serve our community over the next 5 years. So these are sites that we're looking to that our needs today, but what are we also going to have to use more than this?
Any questions or comments?
I've not been a fan of this project so far, and I'm not convinced yet. The populations haven't shifted so dramatically in the last few decades. There are still people in Hawaii, another hospital, the logistic the northern area. But going from six highway drives down to 2 highway drives, and that means students and parks are going to have to play farther for more time to use and actually have job sites. There are other factors. I'm still not a fan of that. However, I am a fan of communication negotiation. It's going to be a
no more questions, comments. Is there any motion? Second. The motion is second. All in favor, please signify by saying aye. Aye. Opposed. Motion passes.
Thank you.
All right, old business, it appears as though there is none. Before we move to public comment, just a reminder that our meeting that was scheduled for December 4th at 10 o'clock in the chamber, which has now moved to December 11th at 10 o'clock in the chamber. Public comments.
There's going to be December 4th today on the service.
Yeah. Public comment. We've got 3 minutes to
my name is Marcy Kaufman, 106 Gray Street in Carlisle, and I am here to just share some of my concerns regarding the IEP out on the prairie in New Carlisle. I met with Bill Shalio and Jessica Clark on July 5th here and shared these same concerns, and I just share them with you too. First of all, New Carlisle has an already stressed water treatment plant, and that's a great concern to all of we New Carlisle people. So additional industry coming in, that's a huge concern. The safeguarding of our aquifers is, of course, a huge concern for not just New Carlisle residents, but it should be for all county residents regarding the draw and the potential for contamination. So that's something that we obviously need to thoroughly look into. The increase in TIF area in 2016, the county increased the TIF area, and how that affects, you know, the additional tax monies from New Growth and how it gets diverted from our school system, libraries, et cetera, huge concern. This year, breadth of the IEC, it started out as a 22,000 acre plan. Now it seems to, the focus is on 6,000 acres now. However, it still encompasses at least the 22,000 acres as far as planning goes. And it stretches as far north of Nicol Isle as the toll road, and as far south of Nicol Isle, cross Highway 2, clear down practically to the tank. Just the sheer breadth of it is, I just think, industrial sprawl and the potential for industrial sprawl. One component is a potential for redesignating slash rerouting, I'm not sure exactly what it's called, of US 20 versus Business 20 through New Carlisle. Huge concern with GPS, Google Maps, et cetera. We don't want to divert people from coming to our town. So that's a huge concern. The compromise of just our rural nature of New Carlisle, just with the advent of the St. Joe Energy Plant, I am just surprised at how intrusive the new smokestack is, steamstack is, and the smokestacks. It changes the nature of us, and I'm against the new proposed exit from the toll road at Hamilton Trail. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Any other public comments?
Just a question. You are the honorable elected cotton man of Hoffman from the town council, right?
Can you hear me?
Yes.
I'm Deborah Durrell, 21677 Arden Road, Southland. I'm here to talk about TIF and tax abatements with regard to our industry. I recently attended a workshop on this topic, and I want to comment on several industries that have been getting tax abatements from us and how that reflects on our fiscal cliff, and also all of the projects planning starting this next year. The SF Motors plan is a good plan in two ways. Number one, it takes advantage of existing industrial sites, does not take any additional residential or fertile land. Also, they are producing an energy saving product. So that is a good looking forward kind of industry for this county that helps us use and conserve our resources. However, the product that they are making is not affordable, probably, to most of the residents here and probably most of the employees. That is something that we should put on our list to try to make sure that the product that they are making are applicable to the area where we are really needed. Also, this is the first year in 9 years that the county did a checkup on the industries that have been getting tax abatements, and the checkup that they did was inadequate. They only covered two out of the many items on several of these industries, and in almost every case, the industries were severely negligent on their original agreement, on jobs and that kind of thing. However, I am not aware of any consequences that the county has taken on that. I'd like to read the definition of an economic revitalization area that was passed by the Indiana state. Economic revitalization area means an area which is within the corporate limits has become undesirable or impossible for development. And there's a wiggle room at the end of that that says, or other. It seems that the wiggle room at the end of these agreements, the end of these codes and regulations, is the aspect that the county in its financial crisis, looming fiscal cliff, is continuing to spend money. And I would like to recommend that the county tighten its belt, that the county tighten its belts on these additional projects such as renovation and computer systems until they have addressed the missing money and jobs from these industries that got these millions in tax.
Thank you. Any other public comments? 3 minutes to address the board.
Thank you. I'm again Judith Rubleski, 515 South Main, South Bend, Indiana, 6619. Some comments on the IBC. Not only was there a concern about the possibility of toxicity and drawdown on the aquifers in the New Colorado Prairie area, but also the recharge ability of these aquifers if the land is not is covered with concrete or buildings, so forth, parking lots. I don't know if you all read the Associated Press article in the South Bend Tribune on October 21st on how big corporations that come into an area on the promise of jobs actually ends up creating more of a wealth divide. So, and it was also appeared in the U.S. News and World Report. And if you'd like a link to that, I can get that to you if you'd like to read that. It's based on census tract information done by professors of economics at Harvard and other universities. So, and it just came out last month. So there's that. And then as far as what happened in the past with corporations in China from the United States. China was not a democracy, I don't believe it is still. So, but here we're a democracy, we do things differently. We can speak up against how our land is used. And as we all know, corporations over the years have been being allowed to not have any accountability legally. And now they're considered a person by our Supreme Court. So I think this idea of having a security deposit by corporations, of any corporation, especially an internationally based one from another country, to kind of hold it as security deposit that they do abide by the tax abatement regulations, that agreement. We need that kind of security. Certainly, we have to start thinking like bankers, I think. So there's that. I think those are all my comments. Thank you very much. I can't imagine all the work you have to keep up with. I just can't. I appreciate it.
Thank you. Thank you. Any other public comments?
Dan Caruso, 305 Compton Street, New Carlisle, Indiana. My comments will be short and sweet. I make my comments based on what I hear at the meeting. And I too was at the workshop last Thursday. Came involved with them several months ago. Was poisoned my water. And I've heard so many different issues, particularly at that workshop we had last week, about the guarantees these companies get with the tax abatements. And then they showed us that they were expected to deliver a certain amount of jobs and basically haven't followed up on it. Understanding that they're short staffing over here to have somebody monitor these things, whether you hire a staff to do that, or as this idea that Judy Rubleski came with today, the 2-7 composite, basically guaranteeing that if you don't meet what you told us you're going to do with your company coming in here with employment, with maintaining the property, not poisoning us. We've got 2/7 deposit, and we've got at least some money from you, where now they're, as we heard, there's nothing happening. These companies are getting off scot-free. There's nothing in a memorandum which can be written into the abatement agreement, as I understand, saying this is what you'll pay, this is what it'll cost you if you don't meet the obligations that you said you were going to do. Apparently there's ambiguous language on it that says we may go back and review, or we could go back and review the terms, or we could find you. I'm for get ambiguity completely out of there and say you will, and that 2/7 deposit would take ambiguity out of the equation. I really think I'm coming up with so many different ideas. Again, water, don't poison my water was my main consideration. I've come up with so many considerations just in these past few months, but I never even thought about their living wage issue, what you're going to do to my to the economy in the area, whether you're going to blow us up population-wise, where you're going to get your workers from. I think this whole thing needs to be slowed down and reviewed extensively before we allow anybody to come in there and just start having a way with us. Thank you.
Just a reminder that both from the tax abatement standpoint, these are all issues from the kind of council standpoint, they're the ones who will see that, who administer that, and should be overseen. That would be the sure to reach out to our fine friends on council to make sure that it's done properly. Any of the public comment? Hearing none. Name and address for the record. 3 minutes.
George Schaefer, Fire Chief, Lakeville Volunteer Fire Department, 117 South Main Street, Lakeville, Indiana. I have a question first and then comment. First, I'd like to know when we're going to see some taxpayer dollars spent in our streets in the southern part of the county. These are falling apart at a very rapid rate at this point in time. Very, very little maintenance has been done over the years. We keep throwing patch after patch on top of patch and side patch. This, some of our holes in our streets have not even been filled since last winter. The other issue comes up is safety for our firefighters. We want to volunteer service. They have to respond from their home, get the equipment in the process. It's makes it unsafe for them to travel, trying to dodge holes, miss holes, or hit bumps in the road, whatever. And then the apparatus responding again, it takes a toll on our apparatus for repairs, maintenance, service, and the time needed to be able to get to those emergency situations. The other situation comes up when our ambulances respond again. Close their response down time. Mrs. Smith needs the medical attention right away. Once they get them loaded in the vehicle, again, they cannot make an expedition response to a hospital or medical facility because the roads are getting so bad. So at the time, we spend some money in south part of the county and get our roads repaired, not just repaired, but upgraded. Grinding them up, doing chip and seal or tar and gravel on them is not fixing the road. Pierce Road has been torn up 3 times in the last 4 years, and tar and gravel thrown on it to call the road. Talked to you, Commissioner Thomas, about that road. You said it's a temporary fix. The thing I've seen in the southern part of the county is not a temporary thing. We end up with it forever. Talking to some of the county engineers, they tell us, well, we don't get the amount of traffic out there that we do in the city, in the northern part of the county. That is true, but the traffic we get is very heavy. We get a lot of semi-traffic out on our county roads. It is a great problem, but you can't tell our farmers they can't run their semis up and down our road. They have to move their commodities. That's what I mean about semi-traffic. Twice a year, very heavy equipment goes up and down those roads. Semis, heavy farm equipment. Sad to say, we don't have our local mom and pop farms anymore. We have a big commercial farm outlet going on. There's many semis and many heavy pieces of equipment on the road. But I ask that a little bit of our tax dollars be started to put in South Florida County to make it safer for all of our taxpayers. The other issue we look at too is tourism. Tourism is not just Notre Dame, it's not just South Bend, it's not just Mississauga.
30 seconds, Chief.
Tourism involves the entire county. We used to have bicycle parades going up and down our road, groups of bicycles, motorcycles like to ride out in the county and view the scenery, enjoy the smells sometimes. We don't see those anymore, you know. We don't see those groups of people coming out anymore in our community. Which it impacts our small town. So they may stop in a small town, grab a drink, soda, lunch, dinner, whatever. But you don't see those people out in the road anymore. In fact, I ride a motorcycle, I don't even ride in this county. I head out of this county because I'm all better with you, right? I just asked that we look at spending more money in our southern part of the county for the United States. Really. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, sir.
Oh, just to comment on a few things from our various citizens who attended the comment. As Commissioner Castelli stated, and as I said earlier, the issue of tax abatement is done by the county. And they did review and renew a new policy approximately 8 years ago that they added actual goals. And you have to earn the abatement. And that there's punishment for not meeting it. The report came from this point. That, as I understand, they ordered the hiring staff, part time staff, to monitor that even better. And the southern part of the county is part of the entire county. When it comes to roads, we have way more roads than we have dollars. When we hear about a lot of these projects being done, some people say, well, everything's being done in green, or everything's being done by lower green. Well, things are going to be done where there's traffic there. And where we can expand our dollars, you know, where generally when we spend money, if we can get an 80% match, 80%, that's almost all free to build. We get an 80% match from the federal state government. That job is in this high volume of traffic there. That project is going to take priority over anything else. There hasn't been a lot of work done on Pierce Road. Some of that was special grants that the state government recently gave us. And quite often things are work in progress. Sometimes that progress might be, you know, a couple months, a couple weeks, a couple months, it might be a couple years. Because the seal has to settle. The redevelopment commission, I think it was 2 years ago, we put money into the town park, so that where the barn is, to help buy those acreages, to keep them natural. I can't remember the full name of the project, and I'm sure you're Mr. Shelley, or Mr. Clemens remembering. And that was to keep that pond and all that water, and I'm sure the environmental people will love to hear that, for the benefit of New Carlisle. And a significant amount of money is given by the county, but the redevelopment commission, that had money to do that. The road money goes as far as it. Now, if you got potholes, the town limits are going to, and that's the town's responsibility. To my knowledge, we have not accepted responsibility for the old 31. That's my knowledge. That's still controlled by this government. We're in perpetual negotiations on that. But as much is done, and a lot is done with the funds we have. I know when I received a complaint, I contacted Jessica Chip or somebody in the highway department, either verbally or telephone or text or fax, and it seems everything is addressed as well as possible. Sometimes not only the answer the question the next year provider, but they are addressed. Tourism, I agree. In fact, one of my notes in my phone is, the change in Lakeville because of the new 31, cars are not stopping there. That's why it's important, but the town has been trying to work with the people. You don't have a bike path there. And I believe Richard Gallio has been working with the town council of Lakeville for several years to that effect. But at the same time, North Liberty, on the other side of the Lakeville Park, they have that same goal and desire. So there are people thinking outside the box. Obviously, people from South Bend, they think about Lakeville. I think one of the great assets we have is the Joshua Tree Store. And I think we ought to promote more of the dinosaur bones and the wonderful things that are available at that location. There's a lot going forward, and there's a lot still going on. And I'm glad we're getting the computer fixed. I'm sorry, took this long, Matt.
Any other public comments?
Happy Thanksgiving.
Okay. Session's in order.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.